Being bandmates with your siblings sounds like it could be the best thing in the world, but in reality, it could be an absolute nightmare. Today, the Jackson 5 is fondly remembered for their bubblegum pop tunes, perfectly coordinated dance moves, and characteristically 70s costumes. The public's first introduction to who would eventually be known worldwide as the King of Pop. However, before Michael Jackson took the mic stand, the group had another lead singer who had to step down as a result. His older brother, Jermaine. While the chemistry between Michael and Jermaine outwardly looked pleasant during their time in the Jackson 5, these performing brothers soon developed a sibling rivalry that became especially fierce years after the group's Motown heyday. Jermaine Jackson being the only other brother to enjoy any major success as a solo artist, his music career was very much overshadowed by his younger brother. This jealousy and competition over the years resulted in the two beefing with each other during the 1980s, with their prolonged feud culminating in the release of a 1991 diss track. However, for Jermaine, family always came before show business, and questioned his brother's loyalty as he soared into new cataclysmic heights of superstardom. Michael was, undeniably, the Jackson family's biggest star. However, the bigger the star, the harder the fall. And as Michael faced allegations, numerous attacks, and career takedowns, Jermaine remained the sibling that most often and most consistently came to Michael's public defense, leading all the way up to his untimely death in 2009 and beyond. Here's the story of the complicated stardoms, musical rivalries, and family dynamics of Michael and Jermaine Jackson. Here's the detail. Early days. Jermaine LeJohn Jackson was born on December 11, 1954 in Gary, Indiana. He was the fourth child of parents Joseph and Catherine Jackson. While his father worked long hours as a crane operator at the local steel mill, Jermaine and his brothers, Tito and Jackie, secretly practiced songs using their father's prized guitar. One night in 1964, after Tito accidentally broke a string on his father's instrument, the trio were forced to own up to their late-night practicing. The enraged patriarch then, out of anger, made his boys demonstrate their newfound musicianship. This performance inspired Joe to manage their new pursuit, naming them the Jackson Brothers. By the end of 1965, Jermaine's younger brothers Marlon and Michael also joined, creating what would become the Jackson 5. After the group won a talent contest held at Jackie's high school, the Jackson 5 began taking their performances more seriously. At that time, Jermaine was the original lead singer of the band. Until 1966, when younger brother Michael began singing lead vocals after his mother witnessed at home his extraordinary vocal ability blossoming, moving Jermaine from the band's lead singer to backup singer and bassist. Each of the Jacksons have shared how tight their brotherhood was during those early years. They rehearsed together, played shows, and shared private spaces, sleeping in a three-level bunk bed in their bedroom in Gary, Jermaine Jackson calling it their first dressing room. The brothers worked long hours and performed in several low-class nightclubs before securing a spot at the famous amateur night competition at the Apollo Theater in Harlem, New York. The group won the contest, impressing Motown CEO Berry Gordy, who awarded the group a record contract in 1968. Going Hollywood. Once launched at a nationwide level, the group became wildly successful, with their first releases making history as the first recording act to score four consecutive hit singles on the Billboard Hot 100 chart: I Want You Back, ABC, The Love You Save, and I'll Be There. Were all songs that wouldn't be the same without the vocal contributions of both Michael and Jermaine. What has often been referred to as a call-and-response duet, the chemistry that Michael and Jermaine had in the Jackson 5 early hits added distinct personality and contributed to their own signature sound. Even though Michael was the standout star of the Jackson 5, he knew how important of a role his older brother played in the magic they possessed on stage. Quote, "Growing up, it was Jermaine I focused on. He'd walk me to school, I'd get his hand-me-down clothes. It was his voice that I first imitated. I loved his sound. He showed me the way." In more recent years, Jermaine has shared his and Michael's very close bond in their early years of fame and success. They often shared a room together with their father, Joseph, next door. he wanted to keep an eye, or an ear, out for his two lead singers. Quote, "Michael and I seemed to spend all our downtime together in those days, and the bond between us was sealed tight. I cannot remember an argument or a fight in our childhood. Michael looked up to me, I looked out for him. On stage, he was always to my right. In hotels, he was always in the bed to the left. If I couldn't see Michael and know he was okay, I didn't feel at ease." So when did this so-called rivalry between Michael and Jermaine come from? Well, it most likely started with the Motown press department and then was fed to industry media outlets as a device to promote the band. The Jackson 5 and their latest record wasn't the only thing marketed towards their young female devotees, but fans were encouraged to get to know the brothers as individuals. Who's the funny one, the sporty one, or the more intellectual one? It seems to always be the case that band members are compared against each other. What special sauce does each member bring to the collective? Of course, fans would have their favorites, which would often incite heated debates on school playgrounds, only stirring up more interest and enthusiasm for the group and its members, but for different reasons. Some may have loved Michael for his cherubic smile and energetic performances, when others may have been drawn to Jermaine for giving the band a more mature edge and his status as a teen heartthrob. The Jackson 5 was a musical act, but they were more importantly brothers. And just like all families, rivalries and competition between siblings can form seemingly out of nowhere. Without the encouragement of outside influences, whether in the form of music executives, fan magazines, or opinion polls, the record label was just as much as the public crafting a rivalry between the brothers, starting with their first solo albums. Michael and Jermaine's solo projects were created to contribute to and strengthen the overall Jackson 5 brand. However, the press was quick to create a rivalry, asking each of them during interviews how it felt to now compete on the music charts. As early as 1972, news reporters were asking Michael when he was planning to leave the group and start a fully realized solo career.
"You just issued a single record on your own, not with the rest of the group. Now, sometimes when that happens in a group, everybody says, ah, he's going to leave and go off on his own. Yeah. Is that what you're going to do?
No.
Why did you issue that single on your own?
Well, then maybe, you know, like they put out a single, like, you know, one record, then they'll put another one out.
Wait,
what? It's all got to be there."
But what the media presented as a rivalry between artists was likely no more than healthy competition between two naturally determined brothers. As lead vocalists in the group, Michael and Jermaine were the only two to launch their own solo careers while still members of the Jackson 5. Like Michael, Jermaine even had a hit with 1972's Daddy's Home, a cover of the Shep and the Limelight song. The single became a gold disc, selling over a million units, and was accompanied by two album releases in 1972 and 1973, namely Jermaine and Come Into My Life, respectively. Although his brother Michael is generally considered as the standout talent in the Jackson 5, Jermaine's voice had its own special quality and was viewed by many as the most soulful of the Jackson family. Aside from music, Jermaine would go on to graduate from Birmingham High School in Van Nuys, Los Angeles in 1973. Late that year, at the age of 19, he married the daughter of Motown Records founder Berry Gordy, Hazel Gordy. The wedding was a lavish occasion, the ceremony itself taking place at the Beverly Hills Hotel. 600 guests were then invited to the Gordy's Los Angeles estate for an elaborate buffet dinner. White tents were erected on the Gordy's lawn and filled with pale blue and white flowers flecked with artificial snow to echo the winter season, cementing Jermaine's position within the Motown family, just as his own were looking to part ways. Leaving Motown. By 1975, Joe Jackson refused to allow his sons to record any more music for Motown due to their desire for more creative control and higher royalty rates after learning that they were earning only 2.8% of royalties from Motown. In July 1975, the Jackson family announced their departure from Motown at a New York press conference. The family's patriarch had already secured a lucrative contract to have the group sign with Epic Records, a subsidiary of CBS, who agreed to give them more creative control over their musical output and offered a royalty rate of 20% per record. Absent from the press conference and the new deal was Jermaine Jackson, who decided to stay with Motown following his marriage to Hazel Gordy. As a result of his departure, the Jackson family's youngest son, Randy, would replace him in the band. Although the Jackson family expressed to news outlets that they were still hopeful that Jermaine would rejoin the group at a later date, quote, "Under his conditions, it'll take a while," Joe Jackson remarked. As for their relationship, with Berry Gordy and the Motown team who skyrocketed the Jackson 5 into international stardom, the patriarch smiled, quote, "You take it as it comes." Even though the group announced their departure from the label, they still remained under contract to Motown until March 1976. Motown sued the Jackson family for breach of contract but allowed the group to record for Epic as long as they changed their name because Motown owned the name Jackson 5. Therefore, the brothers would be renamed and perform there on out as the Jacksons. In the end, Jermaine didn't leave Motown to rejoin his brothers. He believed it was important to stay loyal to those that helped get you to where you were in the first place, and in interviews stated that his marriage to Hazel had nothing to do with his decision. As he saw it, it wasn't him who left the group, but the group who left him by leaving Motown. After the split, Jermaine flew out to Long Island, New York, where the Jackson brothers were performing, as requested by Michael, who had secretly phoned Berry Gordy. The conversation between Jermaine and Michael that night was one that would end in tears for both brothers. Quote, "Michael said he couldn't imagine continuing on stage without me. I said I couldn't imagine being at Motown without my brothers. We slowly arrived at acceptance, not quite understanding how we'd reach this endgame." Jermaine also talked about the guilt that he felt for his decision. Even his trip there that night, in which he intended to show support, had misled everyone that he'd changed his mind. After confronting his father, feeling the disappointment from his brothers, and seeing the unbearable look of sadness on Michael's face, Jermaine painted a clear picture of his family all walking away from him in a bubble that no longer surrounded him. Jermaine has since reflected that the weeks of separation from his family after the Jackson 5's departure from Motown were some of the most difficult in his life. Quote, "The sense of detachment and loneliness was profound. I didn't feel like I had lost my right arm. I felt like I had lost every limb. I had Hazel, of course, but the brotherhood was intrinsic to who I was and everything I knew. When it was ripped away, I felt something tear." From facing pressure and accusations of betrayal from Joseph, to dealing with backlash from Jackson 5 fans who blamed Jermaine for breaking up the group, his wife Hazel recalled Jermaine's sadness as a depression that no one could coax him out of. Michael also talks about the first shows they did without Jermaine in his autobiography Moonwalk. Quote, "I clearly remember the first show we did without him because it was so painful for me. Since my earliest days on stage, and even in our rehearsals in our Gary living room, Jermaine stood at my left with his bass. I depended on being next to Jermaine." From the beginning, Michael and Jermaine always stood side by side. If you enjoyed this, then check out other Jackson family dynamics we have documented in previous videos. Links are in the description box below. Subscribe for part 2 as next we delve into Jermaine's battle in the charts with his brothers and their eventual reunion for the most ambitious tour of the 1980s. A tour so big, it almost destroyed them.